What are they planning to inflict on us tonight?
We're going to hear excerpts from Madama Butterfly.
First time I was aware of M. Butterfly, Monsieur Butterfly, was really, it was a logo. It was an M, period, with a image, a graphic of a butterfly. And that was an ad for the play by David Henry Hwang in the New York Times. And I was very intrigued by the logo and what it meant, and eventually started to read reviews of the play, and then became aware that it was based on a true story of a French bureaucrat living in Beijing who falls in love with a beautiful Peking opera singer, and many adventures ensue from that. And it's a very strange story, and I was very intrigued because it was a true story, and I eventually saw the play, and it was a beautifully written play and beautifully performed, very successful. And I began to talk to my agency at the time about getting involved in any film version of that play. And I did hear finally that David Geffen was producing a movie of M. Butterfly for Warner Brothers. And eventually I got to speak to David in his office. I went to visit him, to talk to him, to really basically to pitch myself as director for this project. And he said to me something that was very reasonable. He said, "I'm really surprised to hear that you're interested in this. It just doesn't seem to be the kind of thing that you have done in the past. And I must be frank, I never really considered you for it, because it's, you know," he, in other words, associated me with science fiction and horror films like The Fly and Scanners and so on. And he, that was perfectly reasonable. So he said, "So tell me what it is about this that intrigues you, that makes you want to do it." And of course that forced me to be analytical about my intuitions, which were all I had to go on, and I had to, at that moment, sitting in his office, come up with the reasons why perhaps it was not so unusual for me to be interested in this project. And I said, "Well, you know, my films tend to be, for one thing, about identity. Of course it's science fiction and so on, and there's themes of transformation and themes of the transformation of the body and so on. But this story, which is more naturalistic and more realistic, let's say, than something like The Fly or Dead Ringers, is nonetheless about identity. And it's also about an intensely formed cultural group that's quite unique and small. And I'm very fascinated by groups that create their own reality. And certainly the Peking Opera and the ins and outs of the nature of Chinese culture surrounding Peking Opera, especially as it existed within communist China, was very intriguing to me. It was here we have a real hothouse version of a very specific, very unique culture of performing, and a very long history of the kind of performances and the works that were performed in Peking Opera. So I said, really, in that way, I thought that M. Butterfly was, in fact, not such a stretch for me in terms of theme, but certainly in terms of the actuality of it, it was quite a challenge to be shooting what would be a period piece set in China, something I had never really done before. So after that, David Geffen was convinced enough that we had some meetings with Warner Brothers, and very quickly we got excited about the idea of Jeremy Irons playing the lead. I had worked with him very successfully in Dead Ringers. We had a very good relationship making that movie, and of course he was obviously a wonderful actor, and he seemed really a perfect casting for that role, even though of course he's not French, but we were not going to play the movie in French. It was not going to be a French language movie, even though technically in a way it could have been. And so then the question of casting went to the Chinese character Sun Liling, who will play this character. Now, if you haven't seen the movie, you should stop watching this now, because from now on there will be many spoilers involved. It's impossible for me to discuss the movie without talking about some of the surprises that there are in it. So watch the movie and then come back. So the question is, who will play the woman who is the Chinese opera singer that the Jeremy Irons character falls in love with, who in fact is a man, because it was very traditional in Peking opera for men to play women's roles. And it was really interesting. When the movie was released, there was quite a bit of confusion in terms of the response to the movie, because there had been two movies that came out at the same time. That confused the response, I think, to M. Butterfly. One was The Crying Game, a Neil Jordan film, which pivoted on a woman who the main character falls in love with, who turns out to be a man. That role was played by an actor named Jay Davison, who was really totally unknown. And of course, the name Jay is very androgynous, could be a man, could be a woman. So when you see that name in the credits, it doesn't really give anything away. That movie was very successful, and people were quite shocked in that film to discover that the character that they thought was a beautiful woman was in fact a man. The other movie that came out at about the same time was Farewell, My Concubine, a Chiang Kai-gu film. About what? It was about homosexuality in the Peking opera. Now, the chances of all of these things coming together at the same time was very odd, to say the least. But I now go back to the casting of this character. I was very convinced, after trying to cast several unknown or not too well-known Chinese actors, that John Lone was the right man to play this woman. The problem there was that John Lone, if you have his name in the credits, was quite famous for having done many films, including The Last Emperor, Bernardo Bertolucci's wonderful film. John Lone was the grown-up last emperor, and he was very well known. So immediately in the credits, if it says Jeremy Irons, John Lone, you know that there's a man, and ultimately, as soon as you see him, you recognize him. And I think this was considered a flaw in my movie, because people were not fooled that this character was a woman. They knew right away that it was a man. But actually, my understanding of the real story, having done quite a bit of research and talked to many people who had met the actual people, and also having talked to Bernard Boursicault, who is the man who Jeremy Irons is portraying, it was obvious that everybody except this character knew that this was a man playing a woman in the Peking opera. In other words, it was a man who fell in love with a man, could not admit that he was in love with a man, and so deceived himself. He wanted to believe that this was a woman that he fell in love with. So it was quite a different structure from something like The Crying Game. And it's a more subtle response that you need from the audience, because the audience is not being deceived, but the character is. And that was our approach. And people have criticized the casting of John Lone, not because of his acting, because he's a wonderful actor, but because of the structure that was assumed, that was really not what we were trying to do. So that's a preamble into my experience of the movie, which was very exciting for me, very rich, because of course the tradition of Chinese art is very rich, and also the politics of the time were very intense. The 60s in the West were the hippie years, you know, the years of free love and social revolution that was relatively gentle. The 60s and to the 70s in China were not the same kind of years. It was the years of the Red Guard. It was the years of great, strange oppression. It was the years when art was suppressed and intellect was suppressed and very tumultuous. And so I had to do a lot of research, which is one of the wonderful things about making a film, is that you're forced to do due diligence. You're supposed to, you need to research, need to understand your subject. And it's, in other words, the educational value of making a film is quite a huge part of the pleasure of making a movie. And I did a lot of reading, a lot of research about that period in China and the relationships between France and China at the time, because that is a crucial part of the story as well. And needless to say, the experience of shooting in Beijing was fantastic. I was there with my family, my wife and three children. It was an incredible experience for them. I had never been to China before. And it was so interesting, because it was obvious that even then that China was changing so rapidly. Almost every day that you went out into the street, it was not the same street. And in fact, many of the wonderful hutongs that we shot the film in, these are the old back alleys of Beijing, are gone now. They're completely demolished and replaced by high rises and so on. And in fact, the Chinese were, they couldn't understand why we wanted to shoot there, because to them that was the sort of the bad old history of Beijing and represented poverty and mismanagement and so on by the government. Whereas for us, the textures and the sense of history were fantastic. And of course, photographically, it was wonderful. And I remember shooting, we were shooting in the summer. It gets incredibly hot in Beijing. And we were shooting in the middle of the night, maybe 3 in the morning, shooting night scenes in these little back alleys. And the neighbors would come out and watch us. And I remember shooting a scene with a little Chinese girl who had been brought up by her parents. She sat on my lap and looked at the monitor, and she was watching. It was very magical, very sweet, very gentle, a very congenial, wonderful experience. So for me, who I'd rarely actually shot anything out of Canada before, to be shooting this movie in Beijing, in Budapest, which we shot a lot of the Parisian scenes in, and then in Paris itself, it was quite an adventure for me, and really an incredible experience. Even some of the scenes in which I'm directing Chinese actors who are speaking Chinese, that too was quite a magical, wonderful experience for me as a director.
You like it? Good, I'll send you one for a souvenir.
Oh, thank you.
One of the other delights of making M. Butterfly for me was the fact that I could work with all my normal collaborators. Over the years, I've established a great rapport, and I have a kind of a film family that I love to work with, and it includes Peter Sushitsky, cinematographer. His shooting is absolutely gorgeous in this film. It was really a response to the wonderful textures and the feel of Paris in a period sense, and also Beijing. But the magic goes even further, because most of the film actually was shot in Toronto, Canada, on sets designed by Carol Spear, another of my longtime collaborators. She made it incredibly seamless to walk into a doorway in Beijing and then into an interior that was actually a set in Toronto. Almost all the interiors are actually sets that we shot in Toronto. And of course, at the center of the story is music, because M. Butterfly is a play on Madama Butterfly, which is the title of Puccini's famous opera. And there is a performance of some of Madama Butterfly that we shot in Hungary at the Hungarian Budapest Opera House, which stands in often for the Paris Opera House. It was designed really to imitate the Paris Opera House, and it's much cheaper and you have much more easy access to it. So many people shoot in Budapest for the Paris Opera. And putting on that opera there was quite thrilling. It was really my first interface with opera. Later I have gone on to direct an opera of my own movie, The Fly, in Paris. But that was later. And so Howard Shore, who is another of my wonderful longtime collaborators, used the sense of Puccini, the sense of China, the sense of the period and the diplomatic relationship between France and China, to create an absolutely marvelous score that was not cliched or kitschy in the way that it referenced Puccini or Chinese music, but at the same time gave acknowledgement to that and the flavor of that, and also expressed the inner life of these complex characters. So that was, as I say, my first, shall we say, international movie, and yet I had the pleasure of collaborating with my film family, and I think that when you're on location, when you're someplace out of your normal field of operation, to have these people with you is an incredible source of strength and generosity, and was one of the reasons I think that the film was, to me, a great success.